So today I'll talk about the final frontier of the electromagnetic spectrum. And we can also ask ourselves, is Terahertz imaging the killer application? This is an area of light that's not used very, has not yet found good application in everyday life. And nobody knows the best thing to do with it. I would say, maybe I'll start out with the talk at the end of the talk. We don't actually know ourselves, but I think using some of the unique infrastructure and environment developed at Aalto, we know the right way to go. We know the right way to pursue it, and I'm sure that when someone finds a great thing to do with it, we'll be there. So just let's remind ourselves kind of what terahertz is. I have a picture of a light wave traveling from left to right here, and I've labeled these little peaks with the red circles. And you can ask yourself kind of two questions here. What's the distance between these peaks, and how often do these peaks come by if you sit somewhere stationary, like on this purple line here? And we'll also remind ourselves for the rest of the talk that when we talk about a terahertz, if you sit somewhere and watch the light go by at a terahertz wavelength or a terahertz frequency, it's passing you by 1 trillion times per second. This is where this terahertz label comes from. So now let's look at the electromagnetic spectrum. It has little emblems of probably applications you're well aware of. On the right, all the way on the right, we have microwave. With the radio and the phone. On the left, we have gamma radiation, X-ray radiation, and in the middle, we have this visible light, UV light infrared. So what are our sense of scales here? If we look at the visible, actually more towards the UV, we have a wavelength that's 5/10,000ths of a millimeter, or about 600 terahertz. This is the size of a virus. If we look to the right here in the microwave, actually particularly at the frequency your cell phone communicates with the cell phone tower, we have about 300 millimeters, or the size of a ruler, and that's about 1/1,000th of a terahertz. But what about here? What about right in between infrared and microwave, right here where I've highlighted in green? What if you look at wavelengths about 1 millimeter, or frequency about around 1 terahertz? What do you do with that? So far, the best and the only thing to do with it is space. And in 1986 through 93, NASA flew the COBE mission, and they determined, or I guess they confirmed from theoretical calculations, that 98% of all the photons emitted since the Big Bang are terahertz photons. So if you look into space, the afterglow of the Big Bang, interstellar dust, et cetera, most of the light that's being emitted is terahertz light. So if you're interested in studying space, you have to use terahertz. And subsequent missions have prioritized terahertz. Here's a picture of the Herschel satellite flown 2009, 2013, and it has 4 separate terahertz frequency instruments on it. But these instruments are for measuring terahertz emitted by celestial or extraterrestrial bodies. What about generating terahertz and then looking at and then detecting it and seeing what you can do in a more engineering sense? So if we go back to our electromagnetic spectrum and you're interested in visible light, how would you generate that? You could use a laser. Laser works pretty well, especially today. How about microwave? How about your cell phone? You can use a transistor. But what about this terahertz region, this terahertz gap, so to speak? There's nothing, really. Or there's nothing standard. And actually, there's no single device, really, that's very easy to make the terahertz radiation, and you really have to kind of use heroics to generate it. So what do we mean by heroics? Well, we can do two possible things. We can make short wavelengths really long, or we can make long wavelengths short. And the reason the complication comes in is if we do the laser, short wavelength long, for example, we have a laser and then we have to shoot a special crystal. Detection is the opposite. If we want to make long wavelengths shorter, we have a transistor and then we have to put it through a sequence of diodes that are also fabricated on crystals. So this is kind of this is good indication of why this terahertz region is the final frontier of the electromagnetic spectrum, because you have the other areas of the spectrum have very straightforward mature devices, and you have to do these heroics and on top of that to get anywhere in the spectrum and to access it. But people have tried to make it more usable, less complicated, more accessible. And I think it's interesting for the sequence of this talk to kind of go through this final frontier history, the history of the devices. We can start with the optics. First time anybody generated terahertz radiation with the laser was actually 2 ruby lasers mixing a very special crystal. They got a little bit of terahertz power, but not that much. And then in the 1980s, people spent a lot of time fabricating little spark gaps on top of this crystal, just like your car spark plug, where you turn up the voltage and then it arcs. But instead here, it's sitting on a crystal and they control the arc with a very precise driving of a laser. And then finally, by the 1990s, you could do this with telecoms lasers and telecoms crystals. So is it simple? No. Is it cheap? No. But it's kind of accessible enough that you can start to explore applications with it. How about the transistor side, where you multiply up, where you use these electronic means? The very first one was in 1960s. It's called a cat whisker diode. Someone brings a little tiny wire down on top of a crystal. Similar structure as what Marconi used when he said the first telegraph communication across the Atlantic. This worked well at the terahertz region, but you can't scale it any more smaller to make it work better. So researchers spent 2 decades flattening them, crushing them down onto a flat substrate, clusing it down into a crystal, makes it more robust, makes it work fine. So by the 1990s now, you can, end of the 90s, early 2000s, you could finally do this sort of technique with telecoms type devices and telecoms type crystals. Is it easy to use? Not yet, but it's enough that you can start to look at some applications. So I think for us, especially in electrical engineering, that this technology to do applications research has been accessible for about 20 years. How about TKK at Aalto? I think it's interesting as a side note that we go through here. TKK, 1960s, they started radio astronomy in earnest. Metsähavi's 1970s. This is the first radio telescope in Finland. 1980s, Finland becomes a member of ESA, first European Space Agency project. And then 1990s, Millilab was established to really take the next step in this terahertz metrology. Okay, so it's kind of accessible for 20 years, but it's still very complicated to use. You kind of need a PhD or at least a master's degree to use this sort of techniques. What about standards? Not till 2017. And in this case, it's 802.15. This is the Bluetooth standard. This is personal area network. Water absorbs this radiation. Atmospheric water absorbs it quite a bit. It can't travel very far, so you can't really do long distance communications with it. You have to do area around the body. Okay, so we have complicated technology, mostly used for space, standards that came on very late. I might add it doesn't quite agree with the recent FCC standards. Everything's very difficult. Can we do anything? People have persevered, and they have done some amazing applications. Medicine. Terahertz is very sensitive to water content in any sort of material because of the properties of this water at these frequencies. Here's a very nice image of a second degree, a partial thickness burn on an animal. You can see 10 minutes, 50 minutes, 200 minutes, 400 minutes. You have the visible light image, and then on top of that, you have the water or the swelling, this extracellular edema that you know you get after you get burned, developing around the wound, and you can try to make an assessment of this wound severity and maybe the wound viability based on the distribution of water. How about non-destructive evaluation? We have this is a fantastic image of an IC chip. You can look at X-ray, look at the interconnects, but X-ray is harmful. Also, these systems are expensive. Why not try terahertz? There's an image on the right. Terahertz can pass through these plastic materials with very little absorption, and you can start to see the features beneath it. Communications. Lots and lots of work has been done on communications. Here's an example of one to 2 seconds to transfer an entire HD movie. And this has already been exceeded many times over. So amazing applications. People have done great results. They look very useful. What's the status? Do we have terahertz communication companies, terahertz diagnostic companies, terahertz imaging companies? This was recently posed by a very well-known and senior person in our field last August at one of our biggest conferences. And he asked at the end of an 80-slide talk where he talked almost all about communications with fantastic work, all this great work, all these graduate students, where does this lead? And his answer was nothing and nowhere. It has not gone anywhere. And he proceeded to say that most telecommunication companies are interested in microwave and below, and they have more than enough bandwidth and more than enough data right there. There's no reason to do this complicated terahertz to do communications. He also reiterated that we have a terahertz economy. It's called Earth Observing Systems and Remote Sensing and Radio Astronomy. You know, this is where terahertz exists. It's the final frontier to observe space. Why do we need it for anything else? How about the other industries built around these other areas? Do we have any companies there? Security, NDE, medicine? Not yet, not really. And I should say that I think all these applications are great, and I think that they have a very high probability of success on translating to your everyday lives, and soon you'll be touched by them. But I think we need some sort of win, some sort of killer application to open up the floodgates, and then all this, then the device engineering, the systems engineering, et cetera, will then become more, make more economic sense and drive forward. So what should we do? I think that we should use terahertz space research metrology to pursue novel terrestrial terahertz imaging applications. Terahertz space engineering and terahertz space engineering is very difficult. The metrology is complicated. Everything requires a very detailed accounting of all the parameters, and it's mature. So rather than ignore space and pursue these applications, I think that we should use all of this capability developed at Aalto VTT Mealy Lab to pursue novel terrestrial terahertz imaging applications that no one else has pursued. And if we can get a win there, then I think the rest of it follows. So how about some examples? Corneal edema. Here's a picture, cross-section of your eye. You guys can see the lens. The cornea is highlighted in blue. There's lots of diseases that affect the cornea's ability to maintain its water content. If you don't catch it early in some of these diseases, your eye ends up kind of looking like this. There's some horrendous corneal edema, which is the end point of something called Fuchs dystrophy. What have we done? We have done lots of, we have used space, I think, engineering approaches optimized in space for the spectrum. And I think that we have finally been able to measure this water content with high sensitivity in things that look like cornea. But now we need to do humans. We have to do humans. We can't just do little targets. So what do? We've built systems where we think we can look at the eye. We've used techniques optimized in our space research for the lenses, space research for the mirrors, and space research for integrating this TERS imaging system with infrared imaging system. But what do we know about the patient? The patient is always moving. It's never where you want them to be. So this is not good enough. We can't just measure it when we think it's where it is. We need to try to figure out what happens when it's not where it is, because it will never be where it is. You can't anesthetize a patient and then image them. They need to be awake and moving around all the time. So if you look at the eye, you can see it's kind of like a it's spherical. It has properties that change as you go deeper. This is very similar to the Earth when you're observing it with some microwave or millimeter wave radiation. So we can use, we've developed new computational techniques using space science, our electromagnetic capability with space science, to try to simulate what happens to this target, not when we're perfectly aligned, but when we're offline. And you can see here, these terahertz waves traveling from our parabolic source here, our elliptical source here, coming through this cornea, and you can look where the wave is kind of undisturbed, parts where the wave are disturbed, and parts where you have this kind of chaotic behavior. And now we can try to understand not just the measurement when it's where it should be, but where it's not, located where it shouldn't be. How about imaging without sensors arrays? Terahertz imaging is very, terahertz technology in general is very complicated because you don't have arrays of sensors to detect things, you just have a single sensor. So can we image a large field very quickly, even though we only have one sensor? So we have we have technology that we've utilized for space research. We have this antenna here that's actually quite similar to a telescope that we've taken from space. And then we have this hologram here, which also is inspired by space research to measure antennas, and we are going to use that to do this imaging. Here's an example of this hologram. You can see that we have this wave coming in. It's very nicely contained, very straight, and then we start to hit these different mesas, these different peaks and valleys of this piece of plastic that we've made, and eventually it creates a mess here. What do we do with this mess? We can tune the frequency. The mess changes significantly as a function of frequency. And rather than encode bits and bytes like you get from your wireless communications in these different frequency bands, we can encode spatial information, use some techniques we've obtained from space comms, and then do concealed contraband detection. This is a copper A inside a pocket. And we can do real-time almost imaging of this area with just a single detector. And then finally, how about medicine? We can visualize acute injuries. Here's a first, second, and third degree burn. There, we want to get down deep to see how much this has been affected. You can see from this picture, it's quite messy. So we got it. What should we do? We can do something that you can get utilize from remote sensing. In this case, this is like ground penetrating radar. We take the laser version, we take the diode version, we put it together, we make the kind of the system as dumb as possible, but as sensitive as possible. And we can generate these beautiful images of the burn and then also the water around the burn. But what's more is we can generate a time series of this, and we can watch as the water moves around. So we don't care where the water is at any given time, but we care how it moves along this spatial temporal contrast. And you can see that there's no water in the middle of the burn. It's around the burn as you go from this 0 to 7 hours, which is something that's never been visualized before in any sort of technology. So what's the killer application? We have many that we're pursuing. I think that a lot of these, the other groups in the world are not very far, and the reason that we've been able to successfully pursue them is that we have continued excellence in Terahertz metrology for space. And that really drives the application research forward. So I'd like to finish with a quote from Antti Räisänen, who's the former head of Radiolab here, and I'll paraphrase a talk that he gave in 2017. Now is the time for Aalto to take the next step to less known spectrum, to go strongly to Terahertz frequencies in academic research, and especially metrology. And I think the way forward is this novel applications research, especially the Terahertz imaging. And the vehicle for that is the continued excellence in space metrology. And Aalto is the right place to do it at. Thank you.